Hello and welcome to Ukraine in Flames, a special project by Ukraine Crisis Media Center, Ukraine Catholic University's Analytical Center, and NGO Euro-Atlantic Course. My name is Alexandra Tsakhanovska. I'm the head of Hybrid Warfare Analytical Group at UCMC, introducing the topic of today's discussion, the Great Russian Culture, as it is known. It often serves as a last line of defense for those who do not wish to acknowledge the shared responsibility of Russian society for the war, insisting it's Putin's personal misdoing. For example, how can the nation of Pushkin and Bolshoi Theater be held accountable in general for the war crimes committed in Ukraine? This must be some sort of mistake that has to be corrected swiftly, and then we can all go back together to living peacefully, enjoying the great Russian culture. Nevertheless, this approach is problematic. We often talk about Russian culture as something absolutely good and something absolutely monolith, but a more careful approach and perception is needed. If you want to know more, please subscribe to our channel to stay tuned, and don't forget to like and share this video. Today we will talk about how colonialism and cultural appropriation partly made Russian culture great, and about how it often bears an imperial code inside itself. We start with the Director General of Mystetskyi Arsenal, Olesya Ostrovska-Liuta, who discusses many assumptions about the so-called mysterious Russian soul and how it affects representation and perception of Russia abroad and how it manifests in Moscow's imperial ambitions and much more.
One of the basic assumptions that we Ukrainians had to deal with, the assumption about the nature of Russian culture, which we often saw on the Western intellectual scene, has been that Russian culture is about a very mysterious Russian soul, a soul that can combine both the highest and the lowest, where the good and the evil are tightly intertwined. Take, for example, writings of Fyodor Dostoevsky. You have the highest and the lowest in the same person. And the moment you see the lowest, you should expect the highest somewhere nearby. So the moment you see atrocities or you see an immoral act, be prepared that there is something very good next to it. And this soul is so mysterious that you should leave it as it is, and you should leave the whole political entity of it as it is represented by Russia itself. You should not try to distinguish Russian culture, Ukrainian culture, societies within Russia. You should just leave Russia with its spheres of influence. And that is, of course, an imperial gaze. This is something that we in Ukraine felt very deeply, and we've been objecting to it for a very long time. Now it's time to start analyzing Russian culture also from this colonial or imperial point of view as well. It's time to learn much more about Ukrainian, Belarusian, Moldovan, Georgian, Polish, even cultures, to see many more nuances, to see the picture, which is much, much more complicated than one might have thought. And that would help to understand the world and this part of the world much, much better.
Our next speaker gives profound and detailed examples of how Russian colonialism in terms of culture is not a thing of the past, and how Moscow is still putting a lot of effort into the cultural front lines. Olena Onohda, an archaeologist, offers insights from the exciting field which is so often overlooked.
Ukrainian past and history of cultural heritage is multi-layered and complicated. Russian Empire was always very persistent on taking away our national identity. It all started during Russian Empire times, and it continued in the 20th century during Soviet regime. I'd like to mention just one of the so many, many stories. That's the story of the unique mosaics and frescoes of St. Michael's Golden Domed Monastery. The monastery in Kyiv was erected early in the 12th century in early Byzantine style. The frescoes and mosaics have had really a dramatic diplomatic travels to Moscow, then to Nazi Germany, later back to Moscow, and the majority of them are still being kept in the Russian State Museum of Hermitage in St. Petersburg. After Ukraine has got independent, the history hasn't stopped. Russian Empire continued not bringing back our objects and our artifacts. It all has got to be much more complicated after Crimean annexation and after occupation of Donbas region. Russian archaeologists have organized very many excavations. They dig everywhere, which is illegal according to Ukrainian laws and to international conventions. The UNESCO listed site of Chersonesus, which is a site on the territory of Sebastopol, and it was a unique city built by ancient Greeks in the first millennium before Christ, is now being used as a propaganda object. Russians want to make Crimean history closer to them, and they use it as a site to speak of the Orthodox past. They plan to bring a new museum of Christianity, and when Mr. Putin comes to Crimea, he always speaks about the Orthodoxy in Chersonesus. I can also mention the story of the so-called exhibition of City and Gold in Amsterdam, which is being kind of a hostage in the Netherlands after 2014. The exhibition was prepared by Crimean museums and Ukrainian colleagues. But after the peninsula was annexed, the Amsterdam Museum was hesitating where to bring back the artifacts and objects, while according to Ukrainian laws, these objects are the part of the state property. And it all went to the international court. The hearings about these exhibitions keep going until nowadays, so it's almost 80 years. Once I was part of the Ukrainian official delegation to Amsterdam court, and I was really amazed on how much effort and resource Russians bring into that case. And of course, the direct aggression of Russian Federation, which started on February the 24th of this year, brought much more terrors to Ukrainians. Many museums are ruined all over the Ukraine, and many museums are being just simply robbed. I will mention only one example. This story was being told us by Leila Ibrahimova, director of Melitopol Local Lore Museum. Melitopol is a town on the Azov Sea bank, and the collection of this museum is not very rich, but they had some gold Scythian objects which come from Melitopol burial mound dating back to 15th century before Christ. So the director and her museum team tried to hide these objects in a secret vault beneath the museum, and Russian military guys came on purpose to find these golden objects. Luckily, maybe for museum workers, they found the secret vault and they taken away the archaeological artifacts. If they didn't find these things, maybe they would torture museum workers, they would kidnap people, as they continue doing in many regions of Ukraine. And so, unfortunately, this story is rather sad, as many other stories. Still, I believe in our Ukrainian armed forces. I believe the truth wins, and we'll get our history back.
Our next speaker, Ukrainian artist and curator Olesya Drashkaba, talks about the importance of the cultural frontline, which is evident from the testimonies of our previous speakers. She points to the links between the great Russian culture and Russkiy mir, quasi-ideology focused now on the destruction of Ukrainian identity. Find out why it's not just a Ukrainian problem.
Hello, my name is Olesya Drashkaba. I'm a Ukrainian artist and curator, and we will speak about cultural front of this war. The fact that Russia is fight first on a cultural front was discussed for many years by a lot of Ukrainian and not only artists, writers, philosophers, and other people of arts. After all, it is a Russian culture who served a mystical grail containing the death of the Russian world. In 2 months of this terrible war, Russian statement about de-Ukrainization, genocide of the temporary occupation territories, kidnapping of our children, starting educating of Kherson Oblast in Russian languages and with Russian textbooks, signifies that this war is not about the territory or resources. This war is about destroying Ukrainian identity, the war to destroy our ethnics and our culture. Why does Ukrainian intricate culture bother Russians so much that they sent the thousands of their kids to die? Because they cannot come to terms with our differences. That we are not a brotherly people, not the same people, not a failed state. Ukraine is a separate, independent country which has its own national country. We have our own Baroque, own modernism, own avant-garde. We have a classical music and architecture, our contemporary art, modern music, our myths and our fairy tales. Even our religion icon are very different from the Russian ones. By the way, I will hardly surprise you if I tell you that Russian plan was to take care of our identity and move on to the other identities of the people and countries in their reach.
We will wrap up with a solid historical commentary from Oleksiy, Panych, a member of International Pen Club, who explains how and why Russian imperialism developed after 1991 and why Russian imperialism developed after the disintegration of the Soviet Union and in which form, which choices and why were made by the Russian political elites, and which choices the West now faces when dealing with an aggressive neocolonial power.
Nobody would be surprised to hear that Russia used to be an empire. After all, until 1917, it called itself Russian Empire, so it's clear so far. Somewhat less clear is the next claim, that the new state created instead of Russian Empire in 1922, Soviet Union was still the same Russian Empire under different guise and different name. But indeed, it was the case. Of course, Soviet Union claimed that it was a new kind of state and all Soviet republics are inside of it voluntarily just because they wanted to be socialist and very close to Moscow. And this was more or less believable only until Gorbachev time. As soon as Gorbachev started his perestroika, which in fact was more or less deep liberalization of the Russian Empire, and the same Soviet republics wanted to become independent states as soon as they saw that it was a real option. So what happened, in fact, in 1991 was the second stage of disintegration of Russian Empire. And the West was eager to believe that the story is over and that Russian Federation that remained after 1991 was already homogeneous enough to become a nation state, liberal, democratic, and peaceful. It was a mistake. It was a tragic mistake. Why it was a mistake? There are several ways to prove that, but the easiest one is to look at Chechnya, at Chechen Republic of 1990s. Chechen people wanted a very simple thing. They wanted state independence, they wanted their national statehood After the lead of Georgia, Azerbaijan, Ukraine, Baltic countries, they also wanted full independence from Moscow. And it was very reasonable, because Chechen people in 1990s were no more Russian than Ukrainians or Lithuanians before 1991. So the Moscow, in fact, had a hard choice. Moscow should either let Chechnya go, and that means pass to the third stage of disintegration of Russia, which was still an empire, and Tatarstan would immediately follow the lead of Chechnya, and Dagestan, Bashkortostan were ready to follow, or, as an alternative, Moscow had to switch from liberalism back to authoritarian policy and keep Chechnya inside by force. And that's what Putin did. But after that, Putin drew a very reasonable and logical conclusion. He saw very clearly that the only way to prevent further disintegration of Russia is to recapture, regain the territories that were once Russian, also captured by force. You see, the empire cannot pass to a partial disintegration and just stop there. It's too unstable. The process will go this way or that way. So the only choice for Putin was further disintegration or reintegration. And of course, he opted for the second. In this respect, I would say Putin was very clear, logical, and consistent, and much more realistic than his Western counterparts. Putin wanted to restore the empire. To make the long story short, I would say that Putin wanted to capture, to regain Ukraine sooner or later, in order not to lose Chechnya. So the war of Russia against Ukraine, the aggression that happened this year, was a logical consequence of the events of 1990s. Why I'm saying about this now? Because the dominating mode among Western politicians today is we shall punish Russia, let it suffer, but then we shall help Russia once again to become peaceful, liberal, and democratic. And this would be repeating the same mistake the second time, just because Russia would face again the problem of Chechnya, Tatarstan, all the rest republics I mentioned. Either let them go or keep them by force. The conclusion is, if you keep Russia in its current borders, you are keeping an empire that would become aggressive sooner or later. And the only alternative is to plan and implement careful, controlled disintegration of this empire into something else. Maybe a kind of a commonwealth of several independent states, whatever. But Russia, in its current territory, is still an empire and cannot but be aggressive by nature.
You've been watching this special project by Ukraine Crisis Media Center, Ukraine Catholic University's Analytical Center, and NGO Euro-Atlantic course, Ukrainian Flames. If you find our work useful, please subscribe to our channel, like and share this video. In the description to this episode, you can find information on how you personally can help Ukraine in the face of Russian aggression. When you do that, remember that everything is going to be Ukraine.